Well, let's get started because we have another busy day in our Great Lakes Commission 2021 annual meeting. Good morning once again and welcome. We are pleased to have everyone back this morning and are looking forward to continuing our engaging presentations and panel discussions this morning to be followed by a robust business session in which the commission will be taking action on several resolutions. First, a few quick reminders about effectively participating in our virtual meeting setting. All attendees will remain in listen-only mode throughout the meeting to minimize virtual or electronic disruptions. Commissioners, you may unmute yourselves when called on during a question and answer session and our business session. And during discussions, we ask that you use the raise the hand feature and then unmute to ask questions of speakers and panelists or to offer comments during our business session. Alternatively, any commissioner can submit a question in writing via the chat box to the meeting host, also known as Erica. We have enabled live transcription through Zoom to improve accessibility. As this feature is still being tested, there is likely to be some errors, so please be patient with this. This meeting is being recorded and will be made available at a later date. If you are having any technical difficulties, please message the meeting host and we'll see what we can do to rectify those. Speakers and panelists, please keep your microphone on mute unless you are speaking or called upon to speak. To start us off this morning, we have Scott Morlock, Regional Director for USGS Mid-Continent Region, to provide an update on a recently released report, the Great Lakes Science Forum, summary of remaining data and science needs and next steps. Before I invite Scott to provide his update, I would like to recognize that the GLC has a long-standing partnership with USGS that has been formalized in several memorandum of understanding and cooperative agreements. The first joint GLC-USGS MOU was signed in 2012. Today, I'm very pleased to announce that the GLC and USGS will sign their third consecutive MOU, which will provide the foundation for continued support for coordinated activities between the two agencies focused on basin-wide Great Lakes conservation issues and concerns, including those regarding invasive species prevention and control and coastal ecosystems protection, restoration, and resiliency. With that, I am pleased to introduce Scott, who started his professional career as a hydraulic engineer with the Indiana Department of Natural Resources in 1988. Yay, Hoosiers. He began his USGS career in 1991 as a hydrologist with what was then the USGS Indiana District Office. Early in his career, Scott's focus was on the integration of new hydroacoustic technologies into USGS water monitoring programs. He moved into supervision and leadership in 2003 as a supervisory hydrologist, followed by accepting a position as a deputy director within the USGS Indiana-Kentucky Water Science Center. Scott joined the former USGS Midwest Region team in 2014 as a science coordinator, later serving as deputy regional director for science. With that, Scott, welcome, and the floor is yours.
All right. Well, Sharon, thank you very much. It's a great honor to be speaking with you all this morning. And I believe, Erica, you're going to perhaps advance my slides for me?
Yes, the staff will bring up your slides momentarily and run through them for you.
All right, wonderful, thank you. So again, very happy to be here with you this morning and talk about the Great Lakes Science Forum. So the Great Lakes Science Forum, just to give a little bit of background, came out of congressional language in the USGS FY19, fiscal year 2019, and fiscal year 2020 appropriations bill. And so Congress directed us to do a Great Lakes Science Forum with a broad base of partners to look at potential gaps in science for a healthy and resilient Great Lakes ecosystem. So that was the genesis of this report. I have John Hortness with me, my Great Lakes Science Coordinator this morning, who will also be here just in case there are questions that come up. John was instrumental in leading the Great Lakes Science Forum, as was Leon Carl, who was the former regional director that sat in the chair I'm in now, and also Russ Strock, director of the USGS Great Lakes Science Center. So just wanted to acknowledge their contributions. Next slide, please. Goals of the forum were really to share current science. What's the state of science going on across the lakes to support that healthy, resilient ecosystem? And then identify data gaps and potential areas of concern. We all know the broad level of work and science that are going across the lakes, but this was to look at what potential gaps are there that we could focus on for future science needs. And then prioritize next steps and identify resources needed for a Great Lakes Integrated Science Plan. That was our charge from the congressional language. So we were to come back to Congress and say, what would be some potential next steps and what might their resources be needed for a Great Lakes Integrated Science Plan? Next slide, please. And so we did go ahead and do that broad engagement with partners and stakeholders across the Great Lakes, including tribal nations. We requested input from 42 tribes, worked with tribal organizations such as Glyphwic, Cora, the 1854 Treaty Authority, and several tribal regional conferences where we were able to present the forum and get some feedback. Worked with academia, requested input from 18 university researchers, worked with Healing Our Waters, Great Lakes Coalition, the Conference of Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Governors and Premiers, the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative Regional Working Group, specific input from the science agencies working under GLRI. And then I really want to emphasize and thank the Great Lakes Commission and also the Great Lakes Fishery Commission and International Joint Commission. They were really instrumental through multiple discussions with their staff to help and provide Leon, John, and Russ guidance as we worked through the forum process. So again, to everybody on the Great Lakes Commission, thank you, and the Great Lakes Fishery Commission and the IJC for their contributions. Next slide, please. And we did want to also recognize, as we went through the forum, there were complementary, and we consider them complementary, efforts going on. We know IJC was working on its Great Lakes Decadal Science Planning and also had released its assessment and recommendations for Great Lakes Connecting Waters. So that's a very important piece of course, Great Lakes ecosystem resilience and health. And we also wanted to recognize that the Conference of Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Governors and Premiers regional body, they released their regional body and compact council science strategy. So again, complementary efforts moving forward. We definitely want to make sure that at USGS that we're not replicating or overlapping other efforts, but really rather leveraging those and acknowledging these other efforts going on across the Great Lakes watershed. Next slide, please. So the outcome of this forum that we conducted over several fiscal years was, one, a report to Congress. Congress did require that USGS return a report to them. That report was delivered to them late in this year it was delivered. It had to go, of course, through reviews, all the necessary reviews through the Department of Interior up to OMB and then back. And so that took a little bit of time, but that internal document did get delivered to Congress. And again, it is internal. It is an internal working document for congressional use only. But the good news is we were able to do a USGS publication that summarizes the results of the forum that we did conduct with our partners and stakeholders. And that USGS report is under the USGS publication tab there. It provides a summary of data gaps and science needs, and it does talk about recommended steps needed for creation and implementation of a Great Lakes Science Plan. And I believe John Hortness has or is going to share that link with you, Erica, so that you can provide it to your participants. Thanks. Next slide, please. Summary results from the report. The report recommends that expanded data collection and monitoring is needed to provide basic ecosystem, social, and public health data to support management of the Great Lakes system, and then to support development and testing of models and decision support tools, delivering the data and monitoring results so that partners and stakeholders can use those to manage the lakes, the ecosystems. New science and advanced technologies are needed to improve the understanding of critical threats, such as harmful algal blooms, coastal erosion from high water levels, invasive species, fisheries management, and how those species affect fisheries management. So really that was an emphasis from the report also, is how can we incorporate the new science and advanced technologies that are coming out. And then one of the things some stakeholders and partners emphasized was more structured coordination across basins to inform current and future management decisions. Just touching on that, acknowledging again that there are many of the groups and organizations in the Great Lakes do excellent coordination. We work with those groups across lakes. But just again, this is something from stakeholders that said, well, if there are some gaps in coordination in certain areas, let's identify those and work with those. Next slide, please. And then potential next steps and if directed, and that's again an if, because we don't know if Congress will direct our agency or other agencies to take specific next steps upon delivery of the report. Like I said, it's an internal document, but if we do get next steps, they might include initiating, drafting, adopting, and implementing a collaborative Great Lakes Science Plan. Estimated that would take 5 years, because it would have to be a very inclusive effort. It would want to leverage the other efforts, including the ones I talked about earlier from the governors, the IJC, where we recommend it would recommend an integrated group that includes U.S., Canadian, tribal, and First Nation participants to really get that broad perspective and direction on building a plan. Possible focuses of such a plan could be development of new science efforts, again, using those advanced technologies, remote sensing technologies, remote vehicles, all those kind of things, focusing on gaps to improve decision-making, and then developing those advanced models and decision support tools, the idea of delivering actionable science for management of the resource from the research science that's done, from the data that's collected. Next slide, please. And last slide. So that was a very broad overview, but I did just want to, again, point out that we've got this summary report available, that the information will be shared. And again, to thank all of our stakeholders and partners, including the Great Lakes Commission, for helping us out. It was a bit of a heavy lift, but many hands made that lift lighter. And we greatly appreciate it. We're excited that we can provide information in this forum report, and we'll continue as an agency to work with the Great Lakes Commission under that MOU and with all our other partners moving forward. We recognize we're not a one-stop shop for Great Lakes science. It is many, many groups, agencies, NGOs are doing science, wonderful science across the Great Lakes, and that we need all those partners and stakeholders doing that science. So for us, it's a matter of, if directed, using that direction to work collaboratively with all of you on science planning to help support healthy Great Lakes in the future. So that's it for me on the formal presentation. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Do any of our commissioners have questions? If so, please use the raise your hand feature and Erica will call on you to unmute, or alternatively, you can submit any question to the meeting host through the chat.
And I see Commissioner Wobig.
Hopefully. Good morning. I was not letting me unmute there for a moment. Thank you, Scott, for that, for the presentation and As I mentioned, my Zoom has given me trouble this morning, so apologize if you covered this. I'm just wondering, with the Chicago District Corps getting funding now for carrying out their resiliency study and moving forward, if you have collaborated with them in any way at this point.
Thank you, Commissioner Welbeck. We are very engaged with collaborations with the Corps, and just not only through GLRI, but issues like the rising water levels in the Great Lakes and coastal erosion. John Hortness, let me pull you in here if you're available. What's your perspective on participating in that current Corps effort? There you are.
Trying to join here. I'll work on my camera.
Yeah.
There we are. So hi, Lauren. Short answer is exactly what Scott said. Yes, we're working closely with the Corps. And actually, we helped them develop their original plan. You know, us and other agencies, including NOAA and a few other federal agencies, worked with that coastal resiliency strategy that they started to develop maybe back in 2015, 2016. And yes, we've been actively involved with them, engaged through the whole process. And we just had some discussions, a meeting this summer with the Corps, multiple districts, EPA and others, about what we could do to now help facilitate that coordination now that they do have something in their appropriations language.
Great, thank you.
All right, thank you. Yeah, and just to point out again, Lauren, that we recognize that really we need to be tied in to many of these efforts, working with our other federal agency partners, across the board. So thanks.
I'm not seeing any other questions at this point. I did put a link to the summary report in the chat, so everybody should have access to that. And I see Commissioner Zelazny.
Thank you, Erica. Good morning, Scott. It's very good to hear of the report that you've been working on and reported to Congress. Much like our commissioner from Illinois, I was curious, there's been an effort going on looking at monitoring and research for aquatic invasive species that was authorized by the U.S. Vessel Incident Discharge Act, VIDA Act. And it was supposed to cover all of the Great Lakes, St. Lawrence River, and Lake Champlain. Did you get information on that, and were you able to incorporate that into your study or your list of science, ongoing science needs?
Well, thank you, Don, for that question. Well, again, I'm going to call on John because he's been very involved in that particular effort. So, John?
Yeah, thanks, Scott. And Don, yes, in short, that was part of the conversation. I think you'll note once you read the report, it's a little bit higher level than zeroing in on specific connections like VIDA and the Vessel Discharge Act. We've been actively involved with the EPA through that process. And if you remember the language, it noted EPA would work with multiple federal agencies on that effort. So we've been involved in that as well. In the actual form report, I can't say that there's a specific reference to that area or that topic, but it is definitely covered at a higher level related to invasive species.
Thanks, John. Now you've really piqued my curiosity, and I can't wait to see the summary report.
And Commissioner Nelson.
Good morning, everyone. Nice presentation, and I too am looking forward to the report. But my quick question is, in your upcoming five-year planning process, how are you planning to engage the private sector as well as the universities around the Great Lakes in that five-year plan to assist you in data collection, idea formulation, research, etc.? Thank you.
That is an excellent question. And I think the answer is, it really, we're going to have to determine that, and we're going to have to work with the partners to even come up with this is going to sound funny, but a plan to do the planning, right? I don't think we have a real specific idea about how we might execute the plan, because like John said, it's a very high level on means. But what I would say is to make sure that we are capturing those private sector partners, the academic partners, getting the broad base of information that we need. Now, even I think we're going to have a foundation where we pull in all of this relevant science that's being done by the broad base of stakeholders. And we're going to have to figure out how to do that, how to hear from them, inventory those kind of capabilities, and then use that to identify gaps and then move forward with recommending or implementing a science plan. So I really think, again, it's going to be a big partner effort. If USGS is directed to do it by Congress, I would see us as really being the facilitators and coordinators of that process. So I don't know, John, if you had any other perspective, but I'm thinking that's how things would roll out.
No, Scott, I agree 100%. I think that's exactly right. We would kind of be the facilitator, and definitely this would not be a Fed only effort. This would have to be bringing in all the multiple partners. You saw the stakeholders that were involved in the development of the, you know, the forum report. That group and larger most likely would be needed to really help develop and implement a broad Great Lakes science strategy.
And I see Commissioner Wobig, your hand is raised, I think, again, or is that an error?
No, it's again.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, Don Zelazny's question sparked another question in my mind. And so we have, of course, the VITA legislation that Don was talking about, and we also have the NGWAS, you know, kind of program on the Illinois River. Mm-hmm. Going back to our involvement with the Brandon Road Project, one of our Achilles heels, if you will, that we're finding is, you know, reverse flow currents that occur in a channel that really could be problematic no matter what kind of deterrent technology we put in there. I'm just wondering what capacity you have in either of those kinds of programs related to those invasive species kind of actions that you would be able to engage in some of that research. Thank you.
I think that's an excellent question, and I fully recognize that. And interestingly, when Sharon was reading my bio, I worked up in the Northwest Indiana area using hydroacoustics so we could detect that reverse flow. So that's taken me back quite a while. So that what we really need to do, and we're looking this from a USGS perspective. You know, we're working with the Corps, we're working with Fish and Wildlife, we're working with other partners. But and you referenced NGWAS. One of the things we're really looking at is what technological solutions could we bring to bear? What do we need to detect potential invasive species that might be involved in one of those reverse flow situations? So things like eDNA, we have the technology to look at how the flow is going, but then those technologies to identify potential invasive species. So we understand that with Brandon Road, that is that key spot between the two watersheds, right? And we've got to invest, like you said, in the deterrent technologies, but then also the detection technologies so we can assess the threat. So I think that would be an important part also moving forward with science planning to think about those threats to the Great Lakes and what kind of gaps we have. But in the meantime, we are, as an agency, going to work with our partners to continue to think about how we can protect the Great Lakes from threats like that.
Yeah, thank you. I know that we're challenged budget-wise on our research abilities, you know, through the core funding and non-federal sponsor funding. And so that's where we're looking to perhaps tap into the USGS to assist with some of that needed research as part of that project. Thank you.
Well, you're very welcome. And just to follow up on that too, of course, we don't have a budget yet. We're on a continuing resolution, but our FY22 budget is really looking, both the House mark, I have not seen the Senate mark yet, but it's looking really favorable for increases in USGS budget, particularly in our ecosystems mission area. And I know we're going to be looking at, if we do get some budget increases, at invasive science for invasive species. So we're keeping our fingers crossed that we get an appropriations bill this year so that we can continue to work on that, on items like that, Don.
Great. I don't see any other hands raised at this time. I would just want to follow up on Kay's question in terms of coordinating with partners and all those that are doing science in the Great Lakes region. How are you? I know you mentioned the IJC's decadal science plan, but coordination with Canada and science agencies in Canada, and how do you envision that playing out?
Well, I think, and I'm going to let John jump in here too, but again, I think it's going to be, it's going to have to be that strong partner piece. And Erica, if Great Lakes Commission is willing, Great Lakes Fishery Commission and IJC, we're really going to need some help there to ensure that we do that, because we recognize the Great Lakes watershed, it's got to be a tri-national effort, right? So Canada, U.S., tribe and First Nation. So I think, again, if this is to roll out, it's going to be a big effort. I think it's going to be a complex effort. And we're going to need some help from those willing to help us so that we make sure we engage partners on both sides of the border, Canadian and U.S. waters. So again, I would envision us, if we're directed to go ahead and start working on a Great Lakes Science Plan, USGS, we would be convening you, hopefully, and other partners and saying, okay, what are the next steps? How do we engage all those stakeholders and really do this right and make sure that we don't have a stakeholder or partner gap? That makes sense?
Yes, thank you. Chair Jackson? Well,
thank you, Erica. And again, thank you, Scott and John. We look forward to continuing the partnership between the GLC and USGS. We will now move on to our morning panel discussion on building resilient coastal communities. As previously mentioned, the Commission Standing Committee on Climate Resiliency has been meeting regularly to outline an action plan for a resilient Great Lakes Basin. A part of this work, the Commission recognizes that the concept of resiliency is important to protect public health, agriculture, maritime navigation, public infrastructure, private property, fish and wildlife, shorelines and coastal zones, and ongoing restoration efforts. Today's discussion will focus specifically on opportunities to support our coastal communities and efforts to increase their resiliency now and for the future. Our Commissioner Jim Tierney will moderate today's panel. Jim serves as the Assistant Commissioner for Water Resources with the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Assistant Commissioner Tierney leads DEC's management team for policy and programs to restore and maintain the physical, biological, and chemical integrity of New York's waters, the central mission of the Clean Water Act. Included within Jim's responsibilities is representation of New York's interests on numerous state, interstate, and international commissions with respect to the water quality and resources of the Great Lakes, Long Island Sound, and the New York, New Jersey Harbor Estuary, and the Susquehanna River Basin, Lake Champlain, and the Delaware River Basin. And with that, I will turn it over to Commissioner Tierney to introduce him, his topic and his panel members. Jim? We have a mute problem, Jim.
Jim's never been one for being silent. This is great. As mayor, this has happened to me a couple of times. And mm-hmm. I can tell you that the council likes it.
Mm-hmm.
So Sharon, I see you got a fleur-de-lis behind you, a flag, fleur-de-lis flag behind you.
I do, sent to me by our Quebec commissioners.
Cool.
Yes. Awesome. Not yet, Jim.
Steph is working on our end too to try to help.
Phone number?
Yeah, we. I think we are connecting his audio to his video.
Mm-hmm. How's Jim? That?
Yes, success.
There it is.
Success. Thank you. I kept on. Honestly, I was doing this, and but they kept on telling me the, you know, commission was muting me. I'm sure you like to do that every once in a while, but I appreciate that.
Well, unintentional.
Madam Chairwoman, thank you very much for your introduction. This is a great panel we have today. I just want to start with a few items. You know, interestingly, I think this is very interestingly, there have been some forecasts that portions of the Great Lakes basins may be relatively, and I emphasize relatively, well-positioned to manage the effects of climate change. You know, for example, the city of Detroit has been mentioned as a potential climate haven. And I'm sure people who are listening today, you know, all are familiar with the current and oncoming problems associated with climate change, which are many. So we're having the panel discussion on building resilient coastal communities. So what can communities do to address existing and future climate stressors, particularly along the coasts? And are there going to be climate-induced population fluctuations, including future growth, that could be a stressor on or even an opportunity for our Great Lakes communities? Within my responsibilities in New York State include such matters as dam safety, levees, floodplain management, FEMA flood insurance maps, drinking water supply and drought management, and Army Corps projects. I was at one point 14 years ago told that this was going to be a relatively sleepy portion of my job, but no more. Now, the Great Lakes, as we all know, are already experiencing the impacts of climate change. This includes acute short-term impacts such as flooding or erosion in coastal areas, as well as expected longer-term impacts related to population dynamics as people, including immigrants and refugees, reassess the impacts of climate change on their life. The Great Lakes states and provinces are already doing a lot to address these needs, but we need to recognize and think critically about how our policies and our investments will build resilience in our communities, our infrastructure, our environment, and our economy. Commissioners will consider a resolution later today regarding climate resilience, and our Standing Committee on Climate Resilience is working on an action plan that we're all very interested in to help stakeholders share knowledge and develop better partnerships to bolster future climate resilience. Today's panel will look at some of the short and longer term challenges presented by climate change, as well as the opportunities we have as a region to address these challenges. But at root, it raises questions about what is resilience at the community level and how federal, state, local, and even individual actions can foster resilience. It also raises the question of what makes a community appealing, such that quote unquote climate refugees of various stripes, be they people or businesses, might decide to relocate in your community. Today, we have a great panel to discuss these and related issues. For the sake of brevity, I will refer you to the biographies that are included in the meeting materials. On behalf of the Great Lakes Commission, I'd like to welcome Mayor Walter Sendzik of St. Catharines, Ontario, who is chair of the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Initiative, Mayor Ryan Sorenson of Sheboygan, Wisconsin, Dr. Mathew Hauer of Florida State University, and Joel Brammeier, President and CEO of the Alliance for Great Lakes, who's well known to the commission. Now, for opening remarks, I'd like to first open with Mayor Walter Sendzik for background on the city's initiative and just to familiarize the commission and other participants in the work of the city's initiative. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, Jim. It is great to be here. I'm just gonna start with a brief land acknowledgement, the land in which I am here in St. Catharines, Niagara, is the traditional territory of Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabeg peoples. And I say this as a settler on this land. There was many, many people here prior to the settlers arriving onto Turtle Island. And it's important that we're discussing the resiliency of our communities today when we acknowledge for millennium the peoples that were here that were looking after the resources that we enjoy today. I'm also chair of the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Cities Initiative, mayor of City of St. Catharines. For a geographical location, we're between Lake Erie and Lake Ontario. The Welland Canal runs right through us, and it is one of the largest navigation systems for the Great Lakes in order for the Great Lakers to move all the way from Chicago, Thunder Bay, down into Montreal and out into the ocean. So this is an important part of the Great Lakes, is an important part of our economy, and it's an important part of our identity and who we are. The canal has been a part of our community since the mid-1800s. So we understand navigation. We understand the importance of the Great Lakes and what it means to our communities. I've been in this role as chair for the past year. I've been on the board since 2014. And the reason why I share that with you is because it has informed in me the importance of working together as a binational organization. And I want to say thank you to the Great Lakes Commission for hosting this today. These are important discussions that we're having. And from discussions, we want to see action. And the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Cities Initiative is a group of mayors. We've got 135 mayors that are representative of both sides of this, of our two great countries, all along the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence River. And our task is to ensure that our communities are both protected from when it comes to climate change, but also respect the impact that the Great Lakes have on our communities. And so our efforts are about resilience, our efforts are about protection, our efforts are about drawing attention to the issues that face us, much like the commission is doing. And I'm joined by Mayor Ryan Sorenson from Sheboygan, much younger than me. I think I looked like Ryan when I first became mayor. So Ryan, this is what you get to look forward to as you move into your office. And we both sit on the board. The Great Lakes has been around since 2003. It was founded by David Miller, former mayor of Toronto, and Richard Daley, as everyone knows, the former mayor of Chicago. And over the past number of years, we've been working very actively on things like the algae blooms, the nutrients getting into the Great Lakes, on the rising seawater, the rising lake waters that we're seeing, the fluctuations in lake waters, the invasive species coming into the Great Lakes. Those are just a couple of the examples that we've been working on. And our executive director, Jonathan Altenberg, has been doing an amazing job over the last 2 years as our leader. He sends his regrets. And we have been working very closely with Matt Doss, who's the U.S. policy director for the Great Lakes. And I know he is well known to the commission, and both of whom are doing an amazing job. And I just would like to say congratulations to Erica Jensen for being appointed the commission's executive director. Looking forward to working with you as we all are working very hard, as you'll hear today, on addressing the issues that are increasingly facing our communities along the Great Lakes. We're gonna get into a discussion about sort of the effects of climate change and climate resilience, and what does resiliency look in the community? And you'll see as part of the top priorities that we have as the Great Lakes, it's about that resilience. And so I'm gonna ask Mayor Sorenson to, if I can, Jim, I'm going to pass it over to Ryan. Mayor Sorenson's going to touch on some of the work that we're doing from a coastal resilience point of view. He is on he's on the Coastal Resilience Advisory Panel, and I got to say he's doing an amazing job. He's Sheboygan's an important part of our organization, and Ryan's stepping up to take a leadership role as well. So I'm going to pass it over to Ryan.
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate it. Walter and I have the privilege of being the, I believe, the two youngest mayors on the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative Board. So, you know, maybe in a few years, this will kind of fade away. But thanks so much for that introduction. And thanks, everybody, for being here. As Mayor Sendzik said, my name is Ryan Sorenson. I am the mayor of Sheboygan, Wisconsin. No need to adjust your glasses or have another cup of coffee. Yes, I am a relatively younger mayor. I'm the youngest mayor in our city's history, and I'm currently the youngest mayor in the state of Wisconsin. So I have a great honor and privilege of getting involved with the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative. I'm one of the newer board members as well. But water issues are a top priority for myself and our greater community all across Wisconsin as well. Sheboygan, Wisconsin, just to give a little context of what we're dealing with in my neck of the woods, Sheboygan, Wisconsin, the Great Lakes and Lake Michigan specifically are a huge part of our identity. Sheboygan is the Malibu of the Midwest. We are the number one freshwater surfing capital of the world. We have tourists from all over the world come and enjoy our Great Lakes as well. We have the number one freshwater charter fishing fleet on Lake Michigan as well. So from surfing to recreation to tourism, we check all the boxes. So coastal resiliency is a key issue for us. And this is something that I'm passionate about and making sure we're pushing forward a lot of different initiatives. So I just want to quick highlight a few of the great projects that the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative is working on. There's so much in the hopper and so much that we need to focus on too, because we understand having a collective voice with mayors from the United States and from Canada are the key ways that we can move forward and get some policies put in place so that we can deal with the ever-changing climate that we have right here in our neck of the woods. So I'll just jump right into it. So as Mayor Sendzik said, we have a Mayor's Advisory Council on Coastal Resiliency. This council was organized in early 2021 of this year with the goal of strengthening the ability of local governments to address the increasing risk that climate change has on our Great Lakes, and also understanding some other water-related disturbances in coastal areas with a huge focus on coastal erosion. I know in Sheboygan this past year, we've had beaches wash away. We've had businesses that have had to put out sandbags just to prevent water from rising in their back doors. We've had homeowners that live close to bodies of water on the lake or our riverfront as well too that have washed away, that are just getting eerily closer to increasing damage and falling in. The Mayor's Advisory Council meets monthly to hear from coastal experts on a range of topics and participating in engaging discussions to identify other priorities of coastal needs, making sure that we can overcome different barriers to funding, and make sure that we can have strong future responses moving forward. One of the projects that has come from the council is a summary of needs facing the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence shoreline communities. Primarily, these needs come from several different categories that the coastal summaries have detailed, ensuring that we have a coordinated plan and have comprehensive solutions in terms of how we address these problems, making sure we have a broad form of engagement and making sure we're educating key stakeholders in the area as well about what these priorities are, making sure we have strong operational tools and full data so that we can make strong, sound decisions. And the key, obviously, is making sure that we have affordable, supportive, and accessible funding for all our communities. We all know that funding is a huge component of this. And when you're a smaller city like Sheboygan, you rely truly on a lot of different partnerships from the federal government, as well as the state government, as well as several grant opportunities to make sure that you can have sound, comprehensive funding opportunities to move forward. So now that these needs are compiled, the council is shifting their focus towards drafting recommendations that directly address these needs, and final recommendations will be presented in a final report during our mid-year meeting coming up in February. Recently, the city's initiative concluded a coastal resilience need assessment at the University of Illinois, their Institute of Applied Research, to get a wider picture of what the coastal needs and issues are and what is really going on in our area. We received nearly 300 responses from about 250 municipalities in the United States and Canada. And the survey was also disseminated in French as well for our friends in Quebec. Preliminary fundings from the survey have shown that the coastal communities across the United States and Canada are expected to need more than $2 billion, let me say that again, $2 billion for the next 5 years alone to address coastal resiliency challenges. This is a huge issue, especially in recognizing that many of our communities that weren't represented this needs. So this is only just a fraction of the need of what we need to move forward to really address the impact of climate change and coastal resiliency has on our communities as well. I know in our city of Sheboygan, we always struggle with funding needs. You know, we're getting cuts from the state government and shared revenue. We have other different challenges as well too. So when you address coastal resiliency and climate change, that adds a lot to your bills. When you talk about having a sound financial municipal budget, these are huge conversations that we're having that play a major role in terms of budget and planning for the future. The survey as well showed that two-thirds of respondents have been seeing an increase in level of interest in addressing coastal resiliencies in these issues. This is a huge thing too that we see. I think for folks that live on the Great Lakes or the St. Lawrence cities, Great Lawrence Seaway, we see that we're almost beyond the point of pointing fingers of necessarily saying, who started climate change? Is it global warming? Who did it? What did it? How's it going? We live it every single day. We see rising water levels. We see increasing floodings. We see severity of damage. We know that climate change is impacting us now. We need to get ahead of the game. We need to have such strong, sound action to really move this forward. Among these other issues related to coastal resiliency, the survey also focused primarily on responding to shoreline and bluff erosion, flooding and high water levels, infrastructure damage, increased storm frequency and severity. And we'll, again, like I said before, we'll be releasing the full report in the coming months. And I encourage everybody to stay plugged in with the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative to follow this report. Additional partnerships along coastal resiliency. In addition to our survey, the Advisory Council's efforts and the city's initiative has maintained involvement with a number of programs and initiatives related to coastal resiliency programs. The city's initiative is a strong partner with the NOAA Office of Coastal Management and recently launched a Great Lakes Coastal Resiliency Initiative. This initiative has already offered a series of trainings and webinars. We are coordinating with NOAA to plan for a number of technical support workshops around Lake Michigan this winter to help shoreline communities identify nature-based solutions to the threats of coastal habitat restoration and resources. Additionally, we're receiving two separate grants to work to advance Wisconsin and Southeast Michigan's aims at development project implementation plans that strategically position high-quality coastal resiliency projects for upcoming funding resources. We're also collaborating on a related research advisory master project at the University of Michigan to understand the current state of coastal resiliency support and the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative. Our research also includes a continuing partnership with the University of Illinois to develop advanced technologies that will support coastal planning and decision-making across the basin. All right, hang in here with me, folks. We're doing so much, like I said. Congressional funding priorities. This is a huge thing. There's so much talk going around right now in the United States Congress about funding priorities for Great Lakes communities. The Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, NOAA, as I said before, the Coastal Zoning Management Program and Sea Grants Program are key partners in terms of programs and funding resources as well. FEMA's STORM Act and BRIC program. STORM stands for Safeguarding Tomorrow Through Outgoing Risk Mitigation. The BRIC program, which some folks are familiar with, are Building Resilient Infrastructure in Communities, as well as the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation National Coastal Resiliency Fund. So in total, the infrastructure bill that I'm a big supporter of, and I hope everyone else is, includes funding to address water infrastructure needs, including $15 billion to remove lead water lines and $10 billion to address emerging contaminants. It also includes $1 billion for the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative, $1 billion for the FEMA Building Resiliency Infrastructure and Communities Program, $5 million for the STORM Act, which will allow states to set up low interest loan programs to help communities mitigate natural hazards. So in conclusion, I just want to say there's so much work going on there with the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative. I know Sheboygan is facing many challenges alone, and we're excited to be a part of these conversations and initiatives moving forward so that we can secure some strategic funding opportunities so that we can move forward. So that, I'll turn it back to my friend and the mayor of St. Catharines, Walter Sendzik. Walter, take it away.
Thanks, Mayor Sorenson. I'm going to go over to the moderator, Jim. And so maybe we can bring in Matt and Joel, they can do their updates, and then we can have jump into a discussion, because I think Ryan's provided a lot of information about trigger points that we can talk about as we move into this discussion.
Terrific. Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Really appreciate that. I have a friend who's a mayor who told me that the rubber meets the road right on her forehead. So I really appreciate the service that, and it's true. It really appreciates the service that you do and the incubator of new ideas that the cities and the mayors bring forward that are wonderful to steal from time to time, not to take the credit, but to steal your good ideas that go on in the cities. Now, we have Professor Hauer is our next speaker, just to introduce. He has a very interesting specialty. And we're asking him to please give an overview of what he does, how he looks at things, and the larger scale and local dimensions of people and businesses potentially migrating as a result of climate change or extreme weather. Professor Hauer, please take it away.
Thank you. And thanks for having me here. It's really nice to be here virtually. I'm speaking from Tallahassee, Florida, which is the traditional homeland of the Apalachee peoples. So most of my research is on climate migration with a particular focus on sea level rise. So how people might move in response to essentially inundation in coastal cities. I'm a demographer by training, so I think a lot about population processes. And so migration fits in very nicely in that area. And so I kind of want to very briefly talk about two different aspects related to climate migration in the U.S. that would be relevant for anybody on the line. And those are sort of where people go or where people are likely to go, and then what can we do about that migration? So just very quickly and very broadly, people make migration decisions, even ones related to an environmental hazard, within a very large basket of reasons. So no one sort of moves because of any one given thing. Like, it just because of sea level rise doesn't necessarily mean that people are going to move. They're making that decision within the context of their age, their income, their socioeconomic status, their friend networks, whether or not there's sort of nudges, if you will, to move people. So it's like a buyout potential, and so on. So it's embedded within this. I think to think of it as like a basket of reasons as to why people move. And where they tend to go oftentimes is relatively short distance. So if you think about your own migrations in your own life, they tend to be relatively short distance as opposed to much longer. They tend to follow pre-existing ties. So you tend to move where your friends and your family are already at in terms of a destination. And people also move where they can have increases in their social capital. So they're moving for educational reasons, or for lower cost of living, for instance, or higher wages, right? So all these together are the reasons why people might move because of climate change. If you think about sort of like short distances, are people from Miami, if they're displaced because of sea level rise, likely to move to the Great Lakes region? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe Boston is better as a sender region. In terms of other climate hazards, maybe Nebraska might be better as well, sort of relatively closer to the Great Lakes than, say, Los Angeles. And then what can we do about it as well? Well, because people make these migration decisions within a broader set, anything that we can do to improve our communities automatically, or not automatically, but will help make them attractors. So when somebody decides to move, and they're sort of looking in the map and their sort of finger is going around, it might land on a community in the Great Lakes. And we're starting to see that already to capitalize on a number of things that the Great Lakes have. Natural amenities plays a very strong role in this, and the Great Lakes region has a tremendous amount of natural amenities as well. So to like very quickly summarize, people tend to move very short distances. They tend to move where they already have friends and family, and they tend to move for socioeconomic reasons, like classes and, or education, income, cost of living, and so on. And that the reason why people migrate is embedded within a much broader set of decisions that are oftentimes around not just environmental in nature. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Professor Hauer. And our next speaker is someone well known to us, Mr. Brammeier. Maybe you could fill us in on the federal outlook on resilience, Great Lakes opportunities. Will the Great Lakes region become a climate haven? Any other thoughts you wish to share to get the ball rolling? Thanks, Joel.
Thank you, Commissioner, and to our other speakers. I am speaking from Chicago, which is in the traditional homelands of the Council of Fires, the Ojibwa, Odawa, and Potawatomi. I appreciate the land acknowledgments that have been stated today. And I also wanted to acknowledge that there are, of course, hundreds of communities, coastal communities around the Great Lakes who I am not representing, but I wanted to emphasize the importance of their presence in coastal community resilience decision-making. There are some major, as we've already started to hear about, some major long-lasting federal policy decisions that are going to be made in the near future that are gonna have impact over a decade. And it's really critical that you know people that are in impacted communities are at the table when those decisions are being made. I come to this conversation really because of a conversation that I'm having internally at my organization and with some of our partners around the kind of the two tracks that the climate resilience or climate narrative is on right now. And one of them is about attracting people to the region, as we just started to hear about. And the other is about the impacts of climate change on the people who are living in the region right now. And if you, I'm sure many of you have read it, but I do encourage everyone to look at the New York Times article from July by Dan Egan for a really visceral story about how water impacts on the Great Lakes, climate impacts on water in the Great Lakes are having a direct negative impact on people's lives in Chicago. And I know that's being replicated in other Great Lakes communities across the region. This is a systems problem, right? We can't solve climate resilience for the Great Lakes by taking a parcel by parcel approach. And that can feel really, really overwhelming. I have a couple of assumptions I wanted to mention, and that's to get us started here. And I think it bears stating, number one, that growth, population growth, attracting people to the region, new economic development, like that's a good thing. You know, we want people and businesses to move here and to enjoy the water sustainably. I also want to kind of state the assumption that people in the Great Lakes region are having vastly different experiences as a result of their interactions with the Great Lakes. Some people are having experiencing very negative consequences of the impacts of climate change and through flooding, through drinking water contamination, and through coastal erosion and many other ways. I think that a climate haven is really a place where we can aspire that everybody who lives here today and everybody who lives here in the future is going to be able to enjoy the advantages of being so close to this fresh water that we all share and value so much. So I've talked a little bit about this idea that people we're having kind of two tracks of this experience in the Great Lakes. One is about the positives, the potential haven that we have here. And the other is about the negative impacts that a couple of our other speakers have already mentioned. So I won't go into that in detail. But I want to emphasize that just having a lot of water is not a climate resilience strategy. A lot of these conversations start with, it'll be great. We in the Great Lakes are going to be a haven. We've got an advantage because we have so much water. As we're learning from issues like flooding, having a lot of water isn't on its own, is not a resilient strategy. And so it really is, to bring more people to the region without addressing climate resilience is really the opposite of building resilience. It's building brittleness. And so we've got to deal with these consequences of disinvestment that we have in our communities in order to become a truly resilient Great Lakes region. And to kind of flip that to the positive, I would challenge us to think about what does having low water stress enable communities to become, enable them to do? If you can remove these systemic system stressors, like coastal erosion, like flooding. What does that empower our communities to become? And that's another way of thinking about how we build climate resilience. Second thing, and then I'll talk a little bit about federal policy that's on my mind is the public-private interface. Most of the Great Lakes shoreline is privately held. There's a long history of coastal development in the Great Lakes region that I won't go into now, but we're not turning back the clock on that. And any set of solutions that truly builds systemic resilience for the Great Lakes is going to have to grapple with the fact that so much of our shorelines are privately owned by businesses, by residents, and we have to figure out how we address Great Lakes coastal resilience as a system that includes building really great public benefits and also addresses the fact that we have to manage for the private lands that are also being impacted by climate change. How are we going to learn from other parts of the world, other parts of the United States and North America on how we can cross that threshold so we can talk about coastal resilience at a scale befitting the size of the Great Lakes. The last thing I'll say, and then we can get to the discussion, is we are at a moment, and I think a couple of our speakers have alluded to this already, where climate adaptation policy interest at the federal level is probably the highest it's ever been. There are massive opportunities on Great Lakes restoration, coastal management, water infrastructure that are probably generational, and there are some choices that are going to be made over the next few months and over the next 3 years that are great opportunities for the Great Lakes. I know Mayor Sorenson mentioned the reconciliation bill and the opportunity for coastal restoration funds there. I want to mention a couple of specific areas that I think it's important for the Great Lakes Commission to engage on. One is the future of the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative. If you look back at the track record over the last decade and what's coming over the next 4 years, you'll see that there has been a trend of consistent pushes for growth and eventually authorizations of growth in that program. And so we're seeing permanent authorization increases going through 2025 already. The Great Lakes region has done a really good job at growing the congressional support for those funds. I think we have to start asking the question is, what is that increased support? What is the highest and best use of that increased support? And how can the GLRI evolve to address some of the challenges of the future, like climate resilience, like other parts of the other priorities for the Great Lakes region? And it is, now is the time that we need to start thinking about that and to make sure that communities are deeply included in that conversation. The second thing I'll focus on is the Great Lakes Coastal Resiliency Study. As many of you know,
I'm hoping Joel comes back in soon.
He's holding us in suspense. Many of us know.
Okay. Well, I think Joel may not know that he's been frozen in amber on the screen. So we'll return to Joel so he can talk about the USGS study. But I was while we're waiting for him to reactivate, I did want to turn back to Mayor Sendzik, and we're in New York. We border Lake Ontario. We had huge flooding in 2017 that was eye popping and caused a lot of damage in New York. And some one park, the beach actually moved inland 85 feet just during one storm event. We were not only outdone, and we were outdone by the floods of record in 2017, by the floods that were even higher in 2019. And I just want to turn to you to talk a little bit about on your community, your thoughts on coastal resilience and the impacts and the needs of coastal resilience, in St. Catharines, your community, and how that's affected you, and how, drill down on that at a very local level a little bit, please.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, Jim. And those were two awakening moments, I think, for a lot of municipalities along the Great Lakes to have the high water in 2017. And because we were told, all right, this is not going to happen again for another 50, maybe 100 years. And then 2 years later, it broke those records. And So we didn't even have real time to catch up. And what I mean by that is, when you looked at the, we have three beaches. Sorry, Joel, you were frozen for a minute. So we're just talking about infrastructure and the impacts of high water in our communities.
I just assumed I got the hook, but no, I'm back and looking forward to the conversation.
And so, Joel, just remember that thought. You were getting into the scope of the study. And so we're going to return to you after the mayor speaks and just get that follow-up. Thank you.
And in terms of the impact, Jim, on our community is we have three beaches. One beach is adjacent to our wastewater facility. And so it's the wastewater facilities here and the beach comes down here. There's a road in between. And so as the water was rising, it's not just the natural infrastructure that we become concerned about. It's actually the treatment center that treats wastewater and that goes in back into Lake Ontario. And so, you know, you have a large environmental issue that you have to become acutely aware of. And in 2019, the water came very close to that treatment center. And so it gives you perspective on the loss of natural infrastructure. So for 2017, 2019, all of our beaches were completely covered by water. And we have a carousel. So Portaluzzi is a park, very well known. Anyone who's a Rush fan, Lakeside Park, that's why it's called Lakeside Park. Neil Peart, best drummer in the world, I think, from St. Catharines. That park also has a carousel that has been in operation since about 1920. And so we had to sandbag that entire carousel and keep putting additional sandbags because the animals were under threat in that carousel. And so for us, it was we have to look at our infrastructure, both hard and soft, and say, okay, if this happens again, what do we need to do? How are we going to protect both the natural landscape, but also the very important hard infrastructure that's treating water in our community? So for us, Tim, Jim, when we look at our investments, the erosion itself, we had to spend $4.7 million between 2017 and 2020 on about 200 meters of shoreline. That represents every year, so that's one percentage point. So every $1 million that we spend is one percentage point on our property taxes. So right away, the pressures that we're feeling, and here's the point I want to make, is the water is not our jurisdiction. So for all municipalities, that's under federal jurisdiction. And so anything that comes up from the water, the embankment and the landscape on top, there's the jurisdictional boundaries of, you know, whose is it? So in the city of St. Catharines, as it comes up the embankment, it's the city of St. Catharines and or private property, as Joel was talking about. And we look at it and go, these investments that we have to make are costs that we didn't assume, I would say, 5 years ago. So we have to retool how we approach our risk management budgeting processes, whether we debenture or we add it right onto the property tax current, it still is a long-term impact on our abilities to build resilient communities. And I think when Matt was talking about people moving and people moving into new places, we have to deal with these immediate infrastructure pressures caused by high water. And at the same time, think about what does the next 20 years look like? Because if we hit another high water mark, what's going to happen to some of our infrastructure that's further downstream? So I'll leave it there. I've got some other examples I want to touch on, but I'll leave it there and I'll bring out some further examples as we have a discussion. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And just one thing that was interesting when we were dealing with a lot of the community reaction, at least on the New York side, from the 2019 event, we were very worried that people would go toward bulkheads, big rock, riprap, other things that deaden the shoreline. The point that a number of people were worried, and this goes to Joel's comment about private ownership and private property. People are defending their, you know, longstanding homes and cottages along the lakes. And what can happen if the wrong practices are put in is you basically deaden the shoreline and you deaden the local environment and you end up with a bathtub as opposed to a functioning lake ecosystem. So with that, I just want to turn over to Joel so you can finish the thought on the study that you were enlightening us on. before your system froze up.
Yeah, thanks. It's a good lead in. I know that many of you are familiar with the Great Lakes Coastal Resiliency Study that the Army Corps has been authorized to do in the United States. And the reason, I think the mayor's comments do touch on the reason this is important. We really need a vision for what a coastal resilience goal looks like across like long stretches of both public and private property. And of course there are, you know, this isn't to say that, you know, a federal agency can go in and do something on private property. That's not what this is about. But it is about expressing what's the goal of working at a Great Lakes system scale to restore the coastline. How do both public and private needs fit into that context? What's achievable in those kinds of actions? You know, if you do see, there are areas I'm sure that we're all familiar with. I'm in Chicago with a very intensely developed shoreline. Both public and private in Illinois are extremely hardened. It's a symptom of that sort of parcel by parcel approach where, you know, each landowner, be it public or private, you know, protects that land for the use that is the highest priority to them. And I understand the need for that. We do have an opportunity to step back and take a longer view and start to place public and private shoreline protection in the context of what's actually achievable for a restored Great Lakes, as you said, Commissioner, coastal ecosystem. And I think that's something that we really should aspire to and push our federal agencies to help the region define.
Oh, thank you, Joel. Professor Hauer, I want to say, you know, your phone rings and it's the mayor of Cleveland or Detroit or Buffalo. And they say, hey, we want to take advantage of, we want to make ourselves appetizing. We want to have people land here. We have the water. We have this blue economy. We want to come back. What would be the type of advice you would give, you know, the mayor of Buffalo if they called you up and they didn't want to pay you $200 an hour and you decided to, give maybe $300 an hour and decided to give away some free advice during your lunch hour? Thanks, Professor.
So I would tell them that, you know, think about why somebody would move to your city. So why would somebody move to Buffalo? And then why wouldn't somebody move to Buffalo? And think about what you could control and what you can't control, or Cincinnati or whatever city. And then try and do those things to make it so your city becomes more attractive to other people. And so some of that can be relatively simple in terms of things like affordable housing or better infrastructure. Some of it you can't control around natural amenities or your general climate. Some of it are other things, right? Like, which is around advertising or just simple PR. And it doesn't even necessarily be climate related. I mean, just look at the different responses across the US to the pandemic. And that lodges in people's mind about, you know, where a place might be safe in the future. So some of it's going to be very active about making your community more livable and a better community in general. And then some of it's going to be economic development, and some of it's just going to be straight up marketing and PR. That's what I would counsel, I guess is the way to put it, on a lunch phone call.
If I could jump
in. I just got a lot of free advice. Thank you. Appreciate it. But to turn back to the mayors, and this is sort of a small P political question for you, in your community and your broader experience within the mayor's organization. You know, is addressing climate resilience a priority in your broader community? I know it's a priority for you, but you know, when we get into addressing climate resilience, we're talking about money, right? We're talking about policies, we're talking about restrictions. And so is the broader community supportive of action? And if so, how did that come about?
So if I could jump in, Ryan, we as a council declared a climate emergency 2 years ago, and we have a regional governing body called the Niagara Region. They just declared a climate emergency about a month ago. We had a climate strike in St. Catharines where 3,000 people attended. We're only a community of 160 30,000 people, 3,000 people came out. It shows the concern that our community is demonstrating. And so there's a urgency. It's built into our strategic plan. We have climate resilience and climate adaptation, and those are all built into all aspects of our strategic plan as a city. And I want to go back just quickly to what Matt was talking about. If I was on the other side of the fence and I was to be giving advice to a city, I would say, what's your planning regime? What is your planning vision? What's your planning documents? Because it's great to want all these people and businesses to move to our communities, but if our planning documents aren't reflective of what resiliency looks like, so that means protecting natural floodplains. That means looking at your floodplains today with a new lens of 5-year storms instead of 100-year storms, where you're having maximum levels of water coming into your systems. How are you looking at your stormwater capture? If you're bringing more people into your community, what does that look like from a planning? Because if we don't get it right on the planning side, all the other attributes of what we're trying to achieve are actually going to be harmful to people moving into places along the Great Lakes. And so if I was part of the federal government or provincial or state governments, in addition to providing the funding, I'd say, I want to know what your planning tools are to address it, because that's where really the rubber hits the road. I got a hockey puck right here. So that's where the puck hits the ice up here in Canada, where you really got to.
Walter was ready for that. He had that in hand the entire time. There you go.
It's my stress ball.
Yeah. Interesting. And Mayor Sorenson, how about the same question for you and other thoughts you want to share?
Yeah, this has always been a huge priority, especially in Sheboygan. Back in 1998, a few years ago, I was 4 years old. We had one of these 100-year floods that really hit our community, and it washed away over 100 homes and impacted many, many, many individuals. Basements were flooded, businesses were washed away, and now we're seeing such a large frequency of that. We're seeing the impact of that occur more and more and more. And like I said before, communities that live on the Great Lakes, we see it impact every single one. We're having beaches wash away. We have business owners that reach out to me constantly that show me their stores or their storefronts or their businesses that just show how close the increasing water level is right on their back door. I have one constituent that just emailed me just yesterday too, just, you know, almost begging us to do something about this. And we're trying, you know, and I think we're in Wisconsin, we're playing catch up because municipalities are really strapped right now in terms of what we can do. And we necessarily don't have a full solid plan like Mayor Sendzik talked about. So this is a key initiative that I ran on as mayor, to really develop a solid plan, making sure that we're having actionable goals so we can actually do something about this, because this is an increasing issue for us. Especially in Sheboygan. And I love what Matt and Joe have kind of mentioned too, just about climate mitigation and migration, bringing people that are attracted to water ecosystems. I don't want to play fast and loose with the facts here, but I believe there was a recent study done a while back that showed in the next 50 years or next few decades that the most attractive location for people to live will be Duluth, Minnesota. And I kind of interpret that as the Midwest in general, with the impact of climate change, there's going to be increased frequencies of flooding. There's going to be increased frequencies of wildfires, and these 1,000-year storms are going to be happening much more often. And I was, you know, toot my horn, in the Midwest, we necessarily don't have earthquakes or hurricanes or massive wildfires. So it is an attractive place, especially in the Great Lakes region, where water is very accessible and affordable. In Sheboygan, one thing that I always proud wave my flag on is that Sheboygan, our community, we have the most public access to Lake Michigan than any other municipality in the state of Wisconsin. So that's something that we're proud of, but it's something we have to preserve and we have to keep it that way. But doing that, we're gonna need a lot of coastal resiliency work. We're gonna need a lot of stakeholder support from the state and federal government, because we can't do this alone. We can't just piecemeal this. We need to have comprehensive solutions in terms of what we can do on this approach. But Sheboyganites, like I stated before, we're past the point of, oh, is it climate change? Is it global warming? We know whatever it is. I know it's climate change. Everybody knows it is. We have to do something about it. We have to take solid action and get the ball rolling on some of these pieces.
Very interesting. You know, the point made about setting a plan and in the planning process, engaging the community, educating the community, I thought is very interesting and something that I haven't heard spoken about a lot as of late. But I remember seeing an article where they compared one of the most liberal of liberal cities in the United States, Burlington, Vermont, with one of the most conservative cities in the United States, Greenville, South Carolina. And they both had a major revitalization, and they both had in common a city plan that was developed some 30 years ago, and they stuck to it, and they redeveloped it and redeveloped it, and they kept it going forward. So the two had actually met in an approach. And one of the takeaways from this article that stuck with me was a proverb that, you know, today's progress is yesterday's plan. And I thought that was a simple way of getting that message across. And maybe that's something we have to do a lot more thinking on here in the overall Great Lakes, which is just so beautiful. Now, Joel, you're an advocate. You have a lot of ears on the line from federal and state agencies. I want to give you the microphone to talk about your thoughts as a region on what you would want to see us as state leadership and also the federal technical and other powerhouse agencies that are on the line. What are some of the thoughts on this topic that you or approaches that you'd like to see happen over the shorter term or longer term?
Well, thanks. That we've already talked about the coastal resiliency study on the federal side. I wanted to just quickly comment, and I think it's related to your question on, you know, the mayor's points about the planning at the local level. We've got to be aware that the, you know, when the concerns about climate change come from the community level, and I'm obviously not a mayor, so I don't hear as much of it as I do, but it doesn't always come in the line of climate resilience in the way that we're talking about. Like, it could be a flooded basement. It could be a, you know, power outage in an apartment building. It could be a loss of a beach. And it's really critical that the addressing those challenges gets melded into this long-term planning for coastal resilience. They are really the same conversation. And so we've got to be open to making sure that those immediate needs are taken care of. And they're part of a longer term climate resilience plan. What I want to, what I will say to your question, Jim, is I do want to reiterate that there is a real opportunity, I think, for the next generation of the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative. This has been a highly successful program with a very long track record of funding and now growing funding. And this is a place where we have to be thinking about what does the benefit from that program look like 5-10 years from now, because I have full confidence that it's going to continue and it's going to grow. And so how do we actually build climate resilience targets into the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative that address the expressed needs of communities? Of course, I recognize that this is a U.S. program. There are similar efforts, I know, to advance federal restoration funding on the Canadian side. But how can we potentially unpack that program and set new aggressive targets for building climate resilience as we celebrate a lot of the progress that's been made and some of the focus areas that are already part of that program? So that's one thing that I would really push for. A second thing, and this is much broader and perhaps a little more pie in the sky, but it's, I'll ask, what is the Great Lakes region's role as part of, you know, and I'm thinking about this, of course, through a water lens, in a overall, you know, North America climate resilience strategy. And this is where the binational or trinational character of the region really comes in. Can the great, what are the next steps that we should take as a region to become part of an overall strategy that acknowledges that perhaps is in fact, in the long run, is going to be a haven for many people, but is dealing with reckoning with some really deep challenges we've created by working against nature for many decades here. And that's something where we start to get into, questions about the future policies like the Water Quality Agreement and the role of the countries and nations at hand. But I think there is a gap there that we can't. The Great Lakes, as much as we have achieved as kind of an island unto ourselves, in this problem, we are part of movements of people and movements of money and movements of water that affect the entire continent. And that's something that I think merits some real discussion and thinking about how the policies we rely on in the Great Lakes can elevate us as part of a North American climate adaptation strategy. So. I'll stop there.
Interesting, Joel. With Professor Hauer, I'd like to ask you the same question. You have a lot of policymakers' ears on the line here. Any thoughts that you want to share, from your very interesting perspective on the topic?
Yeah, I mean, I just think it's one of if you think about climate change in the U.S. and climate impacts and what might spur people to move, there's a broad range of impacts. And so, there's a lot of focus on my own research is this way as well, it's on sea level rise, because there's a very clear link between, an area or a city going underwater and then people having to move, where there's lots of very good visuals and analogs in the past with hurricanes, like with Hurricane Katrina or Hurricane Sandy, and right on and on and on with these storms. So it's easy to think about those places or those sort of hazards and think about how they might turn into climate migrants in the future. But there's a number of other ones as well, another climate hazards that keep popping up that aren't just in essentially, the Gulf Coast and the mid-Atlantic and the southern Atlantic. Things like the heat dome effect, for instance, in the Pacific Northwest, and how that might spur people to move across the US to other locations. In which case, somebody moving from Seattle to Atlanta seems very unlikely as a cross-country move. Whereas the Great Lakes to Chicago or some of the other cities might seem much more feasible. Or the deep freeze that Texas had earlier this year that also might spur different types of migration. And I think if we just focus on the US on things like hurricanes and sea level rise, we miss a broader stimulus that might cause people to move outside of just those kind of hazards. And those ones are very large. Like the number of people that were exposed to the heat dome effect in the Pacific Northwest absolutely dwarfs anything that's going to be related to sea level rise in the US. And that's over the century, right? Going all the way out to 2100. And that heat dome effect was this year. It's already here. So I think that in a broader set, the Great Lakes can play a role in there, especially with revitalization. We're seeing this in all over the US with central cities starting to revitalize. Like Greenville was mentioned, and that's a great example of one in the Deep South. You also have Asheville, North Carolina is another one that's revitalizing as well, that are sort of old industrial, southern industrial towns. And so there's a lot of those in the Midwest, and there's a lot of those in the Great Lakes region where we can have this sort of return migration from the Deep South, right, essentially back into, it was the Deep South, out into those areas. And then the reverse migration, we can have that happen again with climate change as a stimulus. Scholars like to talk about this century as the age of migration, that we're likely to see lots and lots of migration. And it is, but I don't want it to just be around, hurricanes and storms and so on. But there's lots of other reasons why people are going to move. And making and investing in your community to make it a better community will go a very long way in helping attract people to those areas.
So Matt, if I could just jump in terms of your research, because we've been hearing more language around climate refugees. So you think of war-torn countries where you have refugees coming from Syria or Afghanistan, and you have from the continent of Africa, we get a lot of refugees coming in because of war and political disruption. Climate refugee is different in terms of, have you been able to see any movement on a climate side where it's the person has just lost everything and they just have to move somewhere? It's not a, I'm going to check off a list of where I can go. It's, I just lost everything. Where do I go?
So that's harder, right? Because like even it, so let me back up again. So I'm not super keen on the term climate refugee. I'm much more, I like the term climate migrant a bit more. We like you said, you think of like war-torn countries and so on, it implies a number of international mechanisms and governance structures that we just don't have for climate change or for climate migration. And then on top of that, like a total destruction of like a reason is to move, we don't have that even internationally yet. But that doesn't mean that we won't have that in the future, right? So there was a big case last year in front of the United Nations with a gentleman who moved from Kiribati to New Zealand, saying that he couldn't go back. He was, lost all of his livelihood and so on. He was deported back to Kiribati. He lost his case. I mean, it was like, it's hard to make an argument that you can't go back when you actually went back to Kiribati. In the US, we have a couple of areas that have been bought out of, as a part of managed relocations in Alaska and Louisiana and elsewhere, almost always with indigenous communities that are involved that are very much at the front line. But we don't have a lot of great examples where people have completely lost everything so far, at least not in the recent record. The closest might be Hurricane Katrina in the US. But there's a number of different factors that go into why somebody would move. So it's not just that there was a Category 5 hurricane. It's that there was a failure of a response. There was, local problems that were arising and so on. So it's not just like one single thing as to why somebody might move. Internationally, it becomes really difficult if we were to try and apply this simply because you could have an administration that comes in that decides that they're going to, you know, not allow people from other areas and trying to emphasize other ones and start shutting down federal programs that then get restarted elsewhere with another administration. So the governance mechanism, around international migration make it so climate migration between countries is much less likely than climate migration within countries. So the U.S. could play a role in that internationally if it decides to do so, right? If leadership decides to do so, if administration wants to, or Canada even, right? If Canada wants to.
Can I jump in on that too, Matt? Yeah. I find all this stuff really fascinating, but there's a lot of conversation about, you know, the Maldives, for example, where they're almost in the middle of the Indian Ocean. I know we're the Great Lakes group, but, you know, when we talk about just international migrations too with climate change, like, is this a country over the next few years that will essentially wash away? And when you have folks that try to, you know, flee and move to other countries, but in situations like that, would you see some major climate migration effects?
Yeah, and there's international agreements already in place. Like I know I'm very familiar with Kiribati, so Kiribati is a great example for it. They actually have a federal plan within their country they call Migration with Dignity, and they're purchasing property in New Zealand to help move people from Kiribati to New Zealand. The Maldives is another one, right? I mean, it's a very low-lying area. So there's a fear in the international community about a potential stateless peoples. Like, how do you have a country and a state if you have no territory, right? Like bounding territory is like one of the fundamental parts of what is a country and a nation. But I don't want to downplay those as saying that they're not important issues, because they are. There's just, you know, 7 billion people in the world, and most countries are not going to be completely, you know, non-territorial in the future. So it ends up being much more isolated. In the U.S., though, we do have that with communities. Like there are whole cities that are going to be swallowed whole by sea level rise. Maybe not New York, maybe not Miami, but certainly in the Outer Banks and Louisiana, parts of of Georgia and so on, that will see their whole communities just no longer, Alaska as well, that will no longer exist. And so those people will almost assuredly have to move without some sort of armoring, whether it's going to be hard or soft, or some other mechanism of protection, like mitigation as well.
Well, you know, I just want to let people know, while you lost my video, I still am able to listen in on audio. I wore a belt and suspenders today. And normally at this time, what we'd like to do is turn it over to Erica to moderate questions that, you know, the commission or other individuals may have for the panel in the remaining 10 minutes or so of our time.
Thanks, Commissioner Tierney and our panelists. So if commissioners on the phone today have questions for any of our panelists, now's the time to raise your hand or send me a question in the chat. And Commissioner Iverson.
Hi, good morning, thank you. I'm alternate associate commissioner for the Quebec government. However, I'm posing this question as someone who has grown up and lived in the Great Lakes my entire life. I think a lot of you have touched on this subject, but not really talked too concretely about it. How do you plan? We've already acknowledged that we need resources for infrastructure for climate resiliency on in the very generic infrastructure way. However, how do we go about, when we talk about climate migration, engaging communities that already exist in our respective cities and regions while creating initiatives, policies, programs for our new migrants, but also for those who, like I said, the communities that are already here, who may also need that support, as well as you start identifying other social infrastructure needs for everyone.
Okay. So I think from an infrastructure, if I understand the question in terms of where we're looking. So here in the region, in the city of St. Catharines, we're anticipating a significant growth because we do have a very accommodating climate. We are one of the areas where we grow a significant amount of fruit. We have 130 wineries, apple orchards, pear. Like, we are the fruit basket of Canada when it comes to food security. And so what we're looking at is, what is our capacity on our water, wastewater? So we're looking now at what wastewater capacities, and saying, as we intensify, or as we anticipate the intensification, we don't want to see urban sprawl. We want to see more intensification in our urban centers. And at the same time, we want to make sure that we have capacity for the next 30 years to absorb that. And these are now forming how we make our investment decisions now, because if we don't, we won't be able to balance that accommodation of who currently lives here, at the same time, who's moving here. From a social point of view, it's also about making sure that we're investing in things like affordable and social housing, making sure that there's enough capacity in our affordable housing systems, and as we anticipate that growth, we also know that there's going to be challenges around the affordability to live in our community. So trying to balance those is really one of the toughest jobs we have as councils and as mayors, because the money is finite, and that's why it's important for other governments to step up. The money's finite, but the growth potential that we're seeing is going to cost a lot of money.
And I also want to say something too, and that's that I don't think that these are mutually exclusive. That helping local current residents and preparing for future ones doesn't have to, you could do something that does both, essentially, right? That does help your local community and positions it well in the future. And so this could be a number of different things that's actually going to improve the quality of life of current residents, will make it automatically more attractive in the future for future migrants.
All right, if there are no other thoughts on that, then I will call in Commissioner Ames.
Thanks, Erica. Another great panel, great discussion, and really appreciated all of your comments. And Mayor Sorenson, I can certainly attest for the wonderful attributes of the of Sheboygan surroundings. As a Wisconsinite, my partner and I paddled the Sheboygan River about a month ago, and we ended our 10-mile paddle at a beer garden. So what's not to like about that?
Put it there, exactly.
Exactly. But more seriously, I'm just wondering your thoughts. I really appreciate everybody's ideas. Jim Tierney's comment about, you know, today's progress is yesterday's plan. Joel's suggestion that we look at climate resiliency and how we build that into the future GLRI funding. But it seems to me that if the stars will finally align and this infrastructure bill will pass, that we have a real opportunity, at least on the US side, perhaps there are similar vehicles on the Canadian side, to begin this more holistic visioning process. I just hope that everybody is thinking about this and is ready to kind of hit the ground running if the House will finally pass this bill and it gets signed by the president. Because what it means for these issues is we're looking at the current bill that the money coming into the state revolving loan funds, both the drinking water and clean water funds, will triple for each of the next 5 years. Half the money will be available in grants, not just loans. And there's language to target it to frontline communities. In addition, each individual state has tremendous leeway in how they structure their priority points and guide that funding for what is seen as critical needs within that particular state. So I hope everybody is thinking about the term of art is these intended use plans that are going to be needed for these SRF pots of money are going to have to get blown up and redone, because the amount of money that's going to be available is just going to, it's a game changer. And how do we, your thoughts on how we might build that game changer opportunity, build climate resilience into the discussion as we are hopefully moving forward with significant additional resources thanks to that federal bill?
I think one way is by making sure that the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Cities Initiative organizations that are sort of the boots on the ground, that are the working in the lower tier municipalities, are able to share their learnings, are able to quickly sort of pivot, if you will, with other municipalities, so that there's not that siloing of effect that we often see. And so whether it's big city or small city or towns, we have to make sure that they all have access to the information, to the plans, to the engineered opportunities, so that, you know, we're not leaving anybody, leaving any municipality behind. And I think the work that the commission does, the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Cities Initiative, those kind of organizations and bodies have to be working closely together, but also disseminating as much to the municipalities as quickly as possible. That's the only way we're going to get it done, is by sharing the information and resources.
A couple things. One, Todd, you mentioned construction grants, and I think it's going to be really critical to demonstrate within 2 or 3 years or 5 years this what was enabled by increasing the amount of funds available for construction grants. I think that story is really, really critical. It's been a dwindling source of funding for several decades, we have to turn that back around. A recognition that, you know, we have hundreds of communities that simply cannot afford to pay for 100% of these upgrades, even on financing. So demonstrating the success of the use of construction grant funds, I think, is going to be really important. And the second thing I'll just mention is that creative ways for communities to address rate structures and affordability is also really important. And so the states can, I would encourage the states to work using the support of some of these funds, you know, assuming that they do come through, to work with utilities to create innovative and creative ways to address how to pay for infrastructure upgrades in a progressive way that is customized to communities' financial needs.
Thanks. And I would just add to the mayor's point about partnership and information sharing, between the city's initiative, the Great Lakes Commission, and the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Legislators Caucus, we all have, resiliency committees and groups that are working together, and we're sitting on each other's groups and trying to share our planning and coordinating efforts. So we've started a little bit on that path as well.
Great.
And we have three more commissioners with hand raised, and we're going to quickly get behind schedule. So I'm going to cut it off after these three commissioners. First, we have Commissioner Piggott, followed by then Nelson and Tim Bruno. Commissioner Piggott.
Oh, there we go. Sorry, I just unmuted. Well, first of all, I want to say thanks to Mayor Sorenson and Sendzik for being on. You guys are where the rubber meets the road. And my question is really comprised of that. Whether or not a single new person moves to a new community because of climate issues, and whether or not there's more money coming in for infrastructure. We know that communities around both the states and Canada need to do reinvestment, and the opportunities on the state side for new dollars is good. My question to you guys is whether or not the communities that you work in are considering how you reevaluate the infrastructure needs for water and drinking water, given the changing climate. For example, here in Indianapolis, where I live, the city has spent $2 billion to upgrade its system to deal with combined sewer overflows. But in that process, I'm not sure that the community has reevaluated the expected wastewater discharges based on the increased rain events that are occurring because of climate change. Can you talk a little bit about how the change in climate in your communities has forced you to reevaluate what your infrastructure needs are?
Sure, I can give you a real life example, Bruno. 2019, we had the high water mark. In 45 minutes, we had the most rainfall ever recorded here in St. Catharines, Niagara, in North St. Catharines, so adjacent to Lake Ontario. 500 homes were flooded within that 45 minutes. One of the reasons that we identified, one is, and it was great that you're talking about the stormwater overflows. We're investing tens of millions of dollars into these in our community, and it's comment on those. Great infrastructure, really important, but it's hard to cut ribbons. So a lot of politicians move away from that stuff because it's underground infrastructure. So we got to get over that. That's one thing. The other thing was in Lake Ontario. So as the high water was up in normal times, here we have a discharge pipe that goes into Lake Ontario, which is just stormwater discharge pipe. In the high water is here. The discharge pipe was underwater. So the amount of pressure that was put on the system would not allow for that water to discharge as quickly when it was underwater. So it was identified as an engineering issue. So now we have to go into that neighborhood and we have to look and say, what is the cost to now raise that discharge pipe? But it is a big infrastructure project, or somehow change it, like you talked about, doing some diversion of stormwater into a holding tank. These are big economic pieces. And if we don't do those today and we get another flash rain like that, the insurance won't cover the houses. So now you get into an insurance issue where houses aren't being covered for flood insurance. It's a cascading impact on people living in our communities. And so that was a real life example for us. And it was an infrastructure. Raise the pipe, more water comes out it was eye-opening for me, the amount of cost it's going to take to adjust infrastructure to try and better align with what could be future incidences that are going to happen in a more frequent way.
And that's on top of the regular expenses for maintaining plant and equipment.
Exactly.
And may not have been anticipated in the past.
This was the first year, and sorry, Ryan, this was the first year that we had blue-green algae detected in our water system. Now, we are downstream. We pull from the Welland Canal. We don't pull from directly from Lake Ontario or Lake Erie. We pull from the Welland Canal. So that blue-green algae from Lake Erie came down the Welland Canal, and we're closer to Lake Ontario, and it was detected within our, and we were able to detect it early enough. There was no impact on the system. But we went from what would be weekly testing to hourly testing when that entered into the waterway. That was, the alarms went off on that one because we saw what happened in Toledo, Ohio. The alarms went off, and that means more infrastructure investments on our water to be able to protect our water. So great examples of what happens when we're dealing with what resiliency looks like, but what an emergency looks like, more important.
And we had a very similar situation to what Walter stated as well too. So I'm not going to belabor the point too on that one. But again, I mean, we're just seeing increased stress on our wastewater facility too. And then you throw in people throwing all these flushable, not really flushable wipes down the drains as well. That's a whole nother topic. But on top of this, it just creates a whole mess. But we have a similar situation going on with our raw water intake as well too. So we have a raw water intake system is about 100 years old now, so it needs a revamp, if you will. So we're starting a $40 million project on this because we have to put the new pipes in much lower to get cleaner water, and we have to put them farther out. So just the cost of price right now, we're seeing a huge increase in that as well too. We need to, like Michigan, it gets cold up here in Wisconsin sometimes, so you have to have redundant pipes just in case if they freeze. But we have to put the pipes lower because we're seeing warmer water on top. And when you have warmer water, algae is more likely to accumulate over there as well, too. And that, again, puts added stress and strain on our water systems. But similar to Walter's point, you know, and with stormwater management, when we're having more rain frequencies, it's adding millions of gallons of added stress onto our wastewater system. And then you know, just tying it with the whole cultural impact of the world right now too, where it's hard to find people that want to work in waste management and water management as well. So we have several jobs opening up that we're having a hard time filling as well. So it puts, you know, when you talk about climate change, when you talk about economic stresses in the world right now, it's just a mess. And we're trying to work through it as well, but you know, Sheboygan and St. Catharines are not unique in these sorts of things as well.
Thank you.
Thanks. I'm going to keep us moving right along here to Commissioner Nelson.
Hello, everyone. Mine's a statement, Erica, so we won't lose too much time. I just want to bring to everyone's attention that something we haven't talked about, and that is the Great Lakes St. Lawrence River Basin Compact and how that manages water use and diversions. And I think going forward to manage expectations of the Great Lakes region being the climate migration locale of interest, to make certain that folks understand that 20% of the world's freshwater does not go everywhere within each of our Great Lakes states. And I was on the negotiation team for Indiana for the compact. I will be retired before you renegotiate it, but that's a lot of work, folks. So don't look to open that back up on a willy-nilly basis. And I see Joel smiling. So thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Commissioner Nelson. And I didn't want to overlook, I did get one question from a commissioner in the chat from Commissioner Montano, and then we'll wrap up with Commissioner Bruno's question. So from Commissioner Montano, this question is for Matt Hauer. Climate migration is extremely important. And when it comes to tribal and First Nations communities, migration rarely is an option for us when our homeland boundaries are fixed. We are only able to carry out treaty rights within our reservation boundaries and ceded territories. Do you consider these issues with your work? And if so, can you speak to it, specifically how populations are impacted when their entire livelihood depends on an area, but migrating isn't an option?
Yeah, so this is an absolutely incredible question. And it's one that my own work doesn't really touch on. So indigenous issues around climate migration is an area that is not at the forefront of my work. Most of my work isn't international either. It's a really big challenge. There have been a few relocations in the US, and most of them are with Native American tribes in Alaska and in Louisiana. But this is a big area that we just don't know much about, and it doesn't get as much attention. There is in the broader area in here, when people do research in this field, they also talk quite a bit about trapped populations. So the people who are essentially willing to move or want to move, but are unable to move as well. And I think that these, you know, for a lot of indigenous peoples, we end up running into trapped populations too. And so, you know, part of understanding migration is also understanding immobility, right? The fact that some people are unable to move, and what do we do about that? For the US, I can't speak internationally, but I can speak to the notion of relocating individuals as well. And the cost associated with it is very, very staggering. In Louisiana, you're looking at, and in Alaska, you're looking at about $1 million per person. And so if you scale that up, you end up with like a very, very large price tag. And one of the things I'm very, very concerned with is that those who are at the forefront will get that funding and have that available, but that the pot's going to run dry for everyone else, essentially.
Thanks. And the last question goes to Commissioner Bruno before Chair Jackson gives us all the proverbial hook.
Excellent. Thank you all. And Dr. Hauer, I think you just hit on what my question essentially is. You know, the Great Lakes communities over the last few decades have seen increasing population movement away from their centers and migration away from the region. And due to that, I think communities have been faced with trying to right size their infrastructure and those types of things that they provide to their communities. It might be smaller wastewater, drinking water systems, or transportation type of amendments. You know, that being said, looking off into the future, I think this is where climate modeling and then migration modeling also will be able to help inform our states and provinces and our communities as to what we should expect in the future, especially in light of, you know, what might be a very generational and transformational investment from our federal government. So that being said, if just very quickly, if you could touch on how you feel some of these climate modeling and migration models can help inform our future planning, both near-term, mid-term, and long-term.
Yeah, so that's a great question too. So almost every, I won't say every, I guess I shouldn't say that, but many communities have long-range strategic planning. Many states produce long-range strategic planning as well. I did population projections, the official population projections for the state of Georgia for a decade when I was there. I worked with local communities all the time. And I know people in Wisconsin and Illinois and Michigan who do population projections and help inform sort of thinking about, you know, the size of your wastewater treatment facility or whether or not you need a new school and those kind of things. And I can almost unequivocally say that across the board in both the US and internationally, I have never come across a population projection for a strategic plan that incorporates climate change inside of it. So they're almost always what I would call climate agnostic, meaning that you're going to sort of say this is what the future is going to look like, but that they don't include climate change inside of them. And if you sort of think about how nascent this literature is in this area, it's like, yeah, we know, but, you know, only for like 20 years, like really not a long time since we get back to the first really like long range climate projections with one of the IPCC reports. However, like I've done some of this work and I used to work for the Atlanta Regional Commission before I was an academic. And so I published a paper where I modeled you know, climate destinations and so on. And Atlanta was one of the ones that was going to pop up. It's relatively close to very vulnerable areas. And so Atlanta would see an additional right around 500,000 residents. And when I showed it to a friend of mine at ARC, he said, this is sort of like the nightmare scenario for me. We're already having a hard time managing growth. What do we do with even more growth on top of the growth that we're having a hard time managing? And so if you think about for even for other regions, like in the Great Lakes, like you had said about trying to downsize or rescale your infrastructure is based on what somebody is sort of putting out or even not even putting out, but sort of a thought about what our future is going to look like. But it doesn't account for all the underlying variables that might actually like be real, like climate change being one. So I think that when you start integrating these together, if you start thinking about long-range strategic planning or just any sort of planning process at all, and incorporating climate change, just even if it's inside the conversation, like what are we going to do about climate change? Just as like sort of that broad level with it, you end up with, I would hope, a better idea of what to do going forward, right? So it helps inform your plan in a much more constructive manner. I was working with a small city outside of Savannah, which is how I got into all of this work. The city is called Tybee Island. It's just outside of Savannah. The highest elevation on the island, it's a barrier island, is something like 7 or 8 feet. And so basically, like by the end of the century, this whole city is not going to exist anymore. And so we asked them, well, how much sea level rise do you want to plan for? And they said, well, what's the maximum we can expect? Right? And that's the thing, is what is the maximum we can expect so we can plan for that? We want to plan for the worst case scenario. And by planning for the worst case scenario, in their case, right, being very bad, being their city going underwater, it would protect them against all other scenarios, right? Because it'd be inclusive of better scenarios for them. And so the same can happen on the reverse end with the Great Lakes, or any other city that's maybe not threatened by sea level rise. And that's that if you plan for a broader range of possibilities, you're likely to capture what the reality is going to be in the future. So if you plan for, you know, this big, you're probably, and the world fits inside of that cone of uncertainty, then you're probably going to be okay. You're probably going to plan accordingly, because you'll have failure, you know, not failure, but, you know, you'll have built in the actual tolerances you need. So, mm-hmm. So that's all I would say is we should plan for climate change in some manner in all of our strategic plans. And I think it benefits all of them.
And can I just add 30 seconds? Because I know we're trying to wrap up. COVID has taught us some of the stuff around migration. And in a real life example here in Niagara, we weren't prepared for the immediate migration of people from offices to work home environments. What I mean by that is our real estate sales. We have one of the 38% increase in real estate sales over 2 years. Our vacancy rates at our apartments are almost at zero. It's an unaffordable community. Within 2 years, we've become, in St. Catharines, an unaffordable community. And so that's an example. We need to learn from what happened with COVID on what people, how people reacted to the same thing that'll happen with climate change and how people will react. It will be disruptive for communities if you're not prepared.
Great, well, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. I just, Walter, Ryan, Mathew, Joel, thank you so much. What I found a very interesting conversation. I've taken down a lot of notes. I'm going to use this in my thinking. And I just want to give you, on behalf of the Great Lakes Commission, express our appreciation and thanks for your giving us your thoughts today. And with that, I'd like to turn it back to our chair, Chair Jackson. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. And I echo everything that you just said. Excellent panel. Very, very informative. Again, we could have spent a half a day on this topic, and we may in future meetings. We will now take, I'm going to shorten our break to 10 minutes. And so if everyone would reconvene at 15:15, we will have the opportunity to hear from our formal observers. So for the next 10 minutes, we are on break. Thank you.